lot of learning from what you have shown, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Inviting
our last speaker today, dynamic surgeon Dr. Kumar from Dr. Rai Institute, Mumbai.
Good morning all, and thank you Dr. Anaga to have given this opportunity to me. I'm going to talk on flax and subluxated cases. So we all know that subluxation makes it a little more tricky to do surgery. So how does flax assist us is what I'm going to show different cases. And even if you have a small pupil and a subluxation, can we get away with it or not is what I'm going to show. So the first case, of course, is this. And this was my first flax. If you talk to the company, they say it's a contraindication, it's off the label use, etc., etc. This was a traumatic cataract, a young chap. And you can see an inferior subluxation. But I feel that everything that has a front always has a back. So the downside, of course, here is the cost of the machine. But you can see the complete down here, this area, where you can see the tilt. So that's the amount of subluxation that is there. You have to adjust your CCC. So what I'm doing here is adjusting the level of the CCC, the size of the CCC. And this is what will determine the size of the CCC. Now, this was my first case, okay? So it's pretty inexperienced. We know that the subluxation is inferior, so I wanted to keep the CCC away. So now I'm trying to play with the size of the CCC, and I made a mistake. So I'm going to show you what mistake I made and how I got away with it. But that mistake itself was a learning curve for me. So now I'm shifting the CCC, okay, with the finger and moving it away from the area of the subluxation towards your incision. So that's one thing I'm doing. And if you move the finger in a different direction, it can increase the size of the CCC. So this is what I've done. So this is where the subluxation is, and this is what I'm doing. And then once you freeze everything and you got a level, go ahead, you can see the tilt. And at the end of the procedure, I got a 3.9 millimeter CCC, okay? So this was some discussion as to how it can be a 3.9 millimeter CCC. So this was one mistake I had made, but that can happen because it was my first case. So not to worry, this is a routine thing, but now I've got better with it. And this is how it was created. Now let's see this case when it happens actually in the surgery. This is the other case, but I will go and show that also. So this is a 3.9 millimeter excess away from the CCC. Now let's see how it looks. So you can notice that it's a small CCC, 3.9 millimeter here. Little bit of fragmentation happened there. As I mentioned to you, it was a young chap, so really nothing much to worry. Made my incision, and since a young chap, I decided to go ahead, remove that CCC, and then do directly a bimanual IA. I want you to see how the posterior capsule behaves during the bimanual IA and how it tries to follow your aspiration port. And that's where we are seeing that the, and look at the behavior of the posterior capsule. So it tries to come with, obviously, because of the subluxation that is inferior. And here I'm going ahead with the bimanual IA, removing the cortical matter. And this you can see that the traumatic part of the subluxation was inferior. The posterior capsule is adherent to the cortex and it tries to follow. But with a slow, gradual procedure, it can be easily removed. Now the small CCC of 3.9 is superior. Of course, this bag will need an endocapsular ring, so we go ahead and place an endocapsular ring. So I inject the endocapsular ring. And now one important take-home message here is that the lens, when it's placed in the bag, the lens will take the center of the bag, irrespective of where we do our CCC. The beauty of flax is that it can do a CCC, of course, where you want, but in a routine case, the flax does the CCC on the center of the lens, so anatomical center of the lens. So here I have not extended the CCC, it's 3.9 off the center. I've placed the lens in the bag, and you will notice that the bag centers beautiful, the lens centers beautifully in the bag. And then of course you make a nick and enlarge your CCC because you want it around 5.5, which is the functional optic of your IOL. So just extending it, making a nick, and then going ahead. So take home message here is the lens always centers in the center of the bag, irrespective of where you make your CCC, whether it's on the visual axis or whatever you decide or plan, but ultimately it centers there. So just enlarge your CCC and that's done. So I'll show you one more case. That was the other femto which I had done. So you can see the subluxation in that area, and that's, this area is the subluxation from here to here. The rest of the zonules are good. We go ahead and do the flax bit of it. Here, the other beauty is that the fragmentation happens in the area of the subluxation tool. Now it become better. So I've done a 4.9 millimeter rexis, and you can see that I can move the rexis towards the subluxation or away from the subluxation. So it depends. Obviously, you move it away from the subluxation, and now we moved it away from the subluxation. You can see subluxation is from here to here, and I moved the rexis, which is 4.9 millimeter away. Don't forget that this fragmentation that you're noticing is actually in the area of the subluxation, which is otherwise just not possible in a routine case. So go ahead and do this CCC and the fragmentation, and that does everything quite well. Let's see this case clinically as to what it looks like. So as I mentioned, that this is the CCC that I've done. This is the subluxation. There is no donesis because the rest of the zonules are pretty good and pretty intact. So that's one big advantage here. And make your incision. And as far as removing the rexis is concerned, we just pinch the rexis off from the center. So that's another big advantage here. And now need support for that area of the back. So I made two side ports, and I always pinch the rexis out. And now I made two side ports, and that's where I'm going to use capsular hooks. So you can notice that I'm using capsular hooks. And again, one more thing to notice is the fragmentation has gone in the area of subluxation. This is only possible because of flax, otherwise it's routinely not possible. This definitely, there is no doubt that flax reduces the amount of phaco energy used in that eye. Now we go ahead and put the capsular hooks. Once the capsular hooks are in place, go ahead and do phaco emulsification. Once the phaco emulsification is done, you can see that once the phaco emulsification is done, one of the hooks came off, yes, and the amount of bag that tried to move forward, but really nothing much to worry here. Just fill up the bag again. Once the bag is filled, we go ahead and put an endocapsular ring. Another take-home message is when you start placing the endocapsular ring, never ever start from the area of subluxation. That's the mistake I made here. I started placing the endocapsular ring in the area of subluxation. One more trick is to loosen the endocapsular hooks before you start placing the endocapsular ring. So I'm placing the capsular hooks now in to hold to the bag again. Once I do that, I've got the support to the bag. And now I go ahead and put the endocapsular ring. So you notice that I've started placing the endocapsular ring in the area of the subluxation, but with good amount of skill, we can rotate the endocapsular ring and make sure that the area of the subluxation is well supported. And once you are in that area, just slightly loosen the capsular hook before placing the endocapsular ring inside. So that will prevent any entrapment or touching of the capsular hooks with the endocapsular ring. So that is what I've done here. Gone ahead and placed the endocapsular ring in the bag. And one more thing you will notice that here you will see the nuck of the endocapsular ring, and this is the area of the subluxation. So what I'm doing here is actually rotating the endocapsular ring and making sure that the area of subluxation gets good support. So this is one take-home message, that never start placing the endocapsular ring in the area of the subluxation. It should always be started on the opposite side. And again, we place the IOL here exactly in the direction of subluxation to give additional support. So I've got the endocapsular ring in the bag, and I'll place the IOL in such a way that the haptic of the IOL gives additional support. The last case I want to show you here is a damn tough case, as I mentioned here, small pupil, irregular anterior chamber, angle closure attack of glaucoma, patient has prostate, heart cataract, and something else was also noted. So this is how the patient came to me. There was a PI done because of the angle closure attack. This is the sphincter atrophy. There was subluxation noted, so you can see the amount of donesis that you see on slit lamp. And this is all that the pupil actually dilates. And now the patient wants a femto. So what are we going to do here? So this is the next case. This is the last one. No financial interest. So I call it challenging the challenge. Patient with irregular shallow anterior chamber, small pupil, angle closure attack of glaucoma, prostate, PI, heart cataract, subluxation, and patient wishes to have flax. So is that possible? So we did try this. This was my first case again. Now much better at it. Took the patient. I took the registration. Once I put the registration, I put in a Melugan ring. Tricks here are that you put a little bit of GV only at the inner lip so that the BSS does not leak. Once that is done, I shifted the patient to the flax, and you can see a small ring in place. The ring is in place. We're doing a small rexis. You can see the subluxation. If you notice, the anterior chamber here and the anterior chamber here are different because of the subluxation that is present. So went ahead and did flax. Then did the fragmentation, so removed the CCC and you'll see some donesses. It's a hard cataract, going ahead and doing phacoemulsification. Now you can see that the bag is a little shaky. Went ahead and put a hook here. I used iris hook because at that stage, maybe the capsule hooks were not available, but the ideal thing to use is a capsular hook. Went ahead and did phacoemulsification. I thought I needed a little more support superiorly, put one more hook. So now I have the Melugin ring in place. Phacoemulsification is almost done. Two hooks in place, bimanual IA. Remove the cortical matter. When once that is done, don't forget that there was a subluxation here, so you need to put an endocapsular ring. So again, I'm going to go and put an endocapsular ring in place. Once, now I've started placing the endocapsular ring to the area opposite of the subluxation. So that's another good take-home message. Once that is done, we go ahead and place the IOL again in the direction of the subluxation. So that gives additional support. So the haptic of the IOL is on the left side, and that's just giving more support to the area of subluxation. So we have the Melugin ring in place, and all of this is under topical anesthesia. So this is all quite possible with flax quite easily. So we have the Melugin ring in place. Remove the hooks. The endocapsular ring has gone in. The Melugin ring is removed, and you can see a little bit of air injected, and patient does quite. This is the first day post-op, little bit of sad keratitis superiorly. Otherwise, the center is quite clear. So in conclusion, flax has a big benefit in terms of CCC. Hydro procedures are made easy. Small pieces of cataracts are less phaco energy. And of course, in subluxation and hypermature cataracts, it has a distinct advantage over routine surgery. Thank you all for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar. That was really excellent. And I thank each one of the speakers for their wonderful talks. Thank you all so much.